Hi guys, sorry about that. Good to have you all back. I will get Akanksha right back as well. Hi Amrita, hi Manika. Hey Pooja, good to see you here. Yeah, 4G is usually smoother, you're right. So I'm actually on really good Wi-Fi. I hope Akanksha comes back on normal internet because that is usually much smoother. Sorry about this, guys. We're just going to get started. It is actually a really interesting topic. It's PR in the time of COVID. I think that a lot of PR agencies can actually get a lot of work done for their clients at this point, because a lot of publications are working online. They're still sending out papers online, so it's great. Hi Tanya, Mommy Diaries. I have a live with Mommy Diaries today at 9 PM where Tanya Kupchandani will be interviewing me, so don't miss that. We'll be speaking at 9 PM tonight. I'm excited about that. Hey Tamira. Way better.
Is this any better?
Way better, way better, way better.
I'm so glad.
I can hear you.
Love. Yay.
So tell me, how's it going? How's the lockdown? You said you're not getting jitters and you're fine.
Yeah, I think it's actually it's a great time for us. I think a lot of lessons to be learned. I think I have a kick-ass team, so they literally kick my ass and keep me in check as well. But, the kind of conversations we've had, the kind of business innovation we have at the current point of time, I think PR has changed completely from what it was before. So I think there hasn't been a more exciting time. And I'm not just saying this, I really, really think that when you see your brand innovate, the hospitality sector has been a little bit of a downer, and understandably so, because, the outlets have shut. If you see what fashion is doing, if you see what corporate is doing, if you see what celebrities are doing, it's insane work. I'm grateful to have such good work.
Yeah, so it's good. It's keeping you busy also. And I think that
very much.
It's good because, like I was just mentioning before you came on, that PR agencies can actually be busy at a point like this because, it's a good time for brands to kind of rework on how, they want to be perceived. And a lot of articles, a lot of online places are still sending out their papers and, of course, blogs. So that's a great thing.
So, actually, Shana, I also feel that it's a great time for PR agencies to brand themselves right now. Right? I think a lot of time, agencies are sort of like general doctors, if I may put it like that. We really aren't. I mean, all my friends who are in the industry will probably second me on this one. But I think that the entire problem statement is not how you make money right now. It's about what kind of value and support you will add. And that's the fundamental difference. And the minute you've got that clear, and the minute you're adding value over money, the partnership's just going to grow, right?
You couldn't have said it better. I think that's one of the reasons I started my lives, is because at this point, you need to support your community and support the people that have been there for you the rest of the year. And I think that a lot of people who come to my events are coming to learn. So why not now, when you're sitting at home and they can learn so much from everyone that is working during a period like this?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. In fact, speaking of learning, the amount of initiative that I see a lot of these PR agencies are, we've been chatting quite often to see what we're going to do, and with brands for that matter. We've been doing so many, brand trainings. We've been doing PR trainings for clients, which we don't get time to do otherwise. We're getting direct access to CEOs and CFOs to chat with them. We're doing internal training, better content. So I feel like this is the time when you actually get to rebuild key messaging, if I may put it that way. So I wish, that everybody would concentrate on PR from that perspective and not just the best that we can do with respect to coverage.
Absolutely agree with you. So tell me, you started The Other Circle in 2013. It's been 7 years uh-huh. now, and you're going very strong. Uh-huh. You have an amazing client list. So tell me how you began first.
You know, Shan, I am what they call an accidental entrepreneur. It's the seventh year. It's the first time I've called myself an entrepreneur at any platform. I have never done this before. because I feel like, you know, if anybody asks me my designation, I say it's primary janitor at the other circle, because I find myself cleaning up behind things way more than working towards it. But I think what happened was, I'm trained by Ad Factors. That's my alma mater. And after Xavier's, I joined Ad Factors and I decided to do my MBA because my father really, really believes in education. So he really wanted me to give it a shot. I'm math dyslexic, so that didn't go very far. So I still remember I got 91 percentile in English. I got 83 in English, in logic, and I got 16 in math. So when I came back with my CAT report, my dad is looking at me really disappointed, going, what are you going to do with your life? And I actually joined as a social media marketing manager at a restaurant back in 2011. And that was my thing because I'm a rider. I ride bikes. So that time Twitter had just boomed and I was a Royal Enfield influencer at that point because I used to ride all across the country.
Wow, and, I know this about you.
Yeah. Yeah, I love riding. I'm deeply passionate about it. So honestly, they followed me because they followed me on Twitter and they said, ki kuch kaam karegi, nahi karegi, followers hai. ये मतलब तीन चार मैसेज डालेगी तो यू नो रेस्टोरेंट का फायदा हो जाएगा. आई थिंक आई गॉट हायर्ड ऑन एन एब्सोल्यूट विम, बट देन आई फेल इन लव विद हॉस्पिटैलिटी एंड देन आई जस्ट स्टार्टेड आई क्विट दैट कंपनी टू ट्रैवल एक्चुअली मच लाइक स्प्रिंग ब्रेक. आई थिंक स्प्रिंग ब्रेक फॉर मी केम आफ्टर वर्क एंड आई बैकपैक्ड ऑल ऑफ कर्नाटका विद माई मदर एंड देन आई रियलाइज दैट यू नो आई नीड लाइक आई कुडंट हैंडल द वे पीआर वाज जनरली बीइंग डन. इट वाज लाइक दिस tight-lipped, only people who have these connects can manage to do this and this mysterious space. And I really wanted to break that mold. And I started freelancing. And honestly, Sham, the work just kept getting so much that I didn't know what to do. So I hired my first person. And then I said, okay, it can't be called Akanksha Gupta anymore. And I can't be sending bills on paper. There needs to be something. So on a very, very drunk night, it got named The Other Circle. The first logo that I paid 1800 rupees on a website and I made the logo on my own. I had no money. I had nothing. I had 20,000 rupees which I had saved up. Luckily, my father allowed me a small space in his office and free internet, which really helped. Other than that, this was just 20 grand in the bank account. One person who I had to pay 15,000 rupees, so 5,000 bucks is in the bank account after that. And yeah, that's it. That was it.
That's amazing. That's really an amazing story. Like you said, an accidental entrepreneur is what you are, but you're a successful one. And like I said, your client list really speaks for itself. So kudos to you for, you know, being
Thank
here
you.
Today. I'm excited to chat with you and know more. So what I wanted to ask you is what all, just so that everyone, as we're getting started, knows what all The Other Circle provides in terms of services and what are some of the brands that you manage?
Sure. I think The Other Circle has moved away from just doing PR, honestly. I think we're more of a communication council, which means that our expertise lies in developing messaging for anything under the sun, as long as it's a sector that we have knowledge in. In certain cases, because of this very strong media connect that we have and understanding that we have, we're also sector agnostic. So, for example, a lot of people know us for hospitality, but that's honestly only 50% of our business. The other 50% is art, culture, lifestyle. We do a lot of work in the e-commerce startup space. We've just started working in logistics. We work with a bunch of celebrities. We do a lot of work in the corporate profiling domain. And it's honestly just grown by the by. We've also grown, honestly, Shan, because as I said, the team's fantastic. So if the team says, hey, we're interested in a play or hey, we're interested in a book, the idea is to sort of take that head on and be as honest about it. So that sort of helped us grow. So services, crisis management is a big one, actually, that we do. We counsel on so many boards of so many companies for crisis management. Of course, we can't speak about that work because of the nature of that work.
Yeah.
Other than that, we do a lot of tier 2, tier 3 cities may brand launches. That's something we undertake as well. We do a lot of FMCG products. We also do their marketing and sales design. So it's a bunch of stuff. We've done we work with a lot of brands like Teva. We work with Bhuvan. We work with Kalki. We worked with Pillsbury. The restaurants, I mean,
Wow.
Bar Stock is home. So, basically a bunch of brands across the country.
Awesome. Yeah, that's great. So tell me, I'm talking in terms of a lot of the people in my network, are starting out. They're much smaller, not on a very large level. But of course, we have a mix of both. So at what stage do you think someone needs to hire a PR agency? And what exactly, okay, let's go with this first, actually. What exactly is PR? And
Okay.
what should they expect from an agency or a freelancer who's taking them on? Because very often I get this question, I paid so much, but I got, what am I supposed to expect? So if you could just tell us a little bit about that.
It's a great question, Shan. Thanks so much for bringing it up. Firstly, PR, as the name suggests, is public relations, which means that any single space that you will connect with somebody outside of your immediate circle is what you should look at PR for. Which means it's all stakeholders, whether it's a customer, whether it's a government body, whether it's a community. At one level, also your employees are your stakeholders. So PR actually should encompass all of these parties altogether, right? What's important is, Shannon was talking to you about how PR has shifted from the years that you and I first probably tried to do something to now. I think what's important to understand is, even for a freelancer, a small company, big company alike, the reason you should hire a PR manager is to get the key messaging right. Don't worry about the spread of it. Don't worry about the vehicle of that nature, because Instagram gives you a lot of voice. Facebook gives you a lot of voice. Communities like yours already give you a lot of voice. So don't worry about what coverage you're going to get. Hire a consultant to get your key messaging correct across stakeholders. That's enough. So let's assume if you're a new jewelry brand, let's assume you're a dog food company. Hire somebody to get that right and to create just a design for you that the execution could be managed on a secondary basis. So that's the key requirement for an agency. Moving further, you asked when they should hire. I think you should hire around 40 days before you hit market. You don't need to hire an agency before that. As long as you know that you've created your positioning right, as long as your research is in place, 40 days before you hit market is when you should hire an agency. Also, I understand that a lot of brands find hiring agencies expensive. That's also because they look at it as an X amount of money going out each month. I think what's important is to look at it phase-wise. So when you're launching a product, that's when you should be expending the most on third-party credibility, which is why expending a lot more in PR. After which you reduce your scope, and then you basically decide what your communication is for the rest of the year. So it's all campaigns are passé. Only doing influencers are passe. It's all about publicity design. You decide the frequency, you decide the stakeholders, you decide how you want to communicate with them, and then you basically sign the agency on for a year or not. It's your choice. But a minimum 6 month engagement to also get feedback, critical feedback from a client, critical feedback from media, and also 14 days before you hit.
Yeah, actually, absolutely agree with you because some people think in 1 or 2 months by paying a retainer, I mean, 1 or 2 months they sign a contract and you're not going to get much in 1 or 2 months. I mean, you won't be able to do enough justice to the
Correct.
entire company. So we have a question from Ayushman
Yes.
Sinha who says he's a big fan and who's your favorite manager to work with?
I think Ayushman is yanking my chain because he can, because I do that to him.
I figured. I figured.
Ayushman is definitely my favorite manager there. I have said it out live that I love Ayushman and I think he's fabulous. But I would be lying if I don't think that I love Chintu as well. Whoever's on the live will know who I mean. They work together, but Chintu, if true, is as much of a favorite.
Okay, great. So we have a question from Pooja Matai who says, should a brand look at sales and PR having a direct relationship, or should we look at it as a means to get there?
It's a question that doesn't deserve one straight answer. It
Yeah.
depends on what product it is. It also depends on the time that you are employing an agency. In case of something like hospitality, there's a definite connection to ROI. Whoever tells you there isn't is lying to you. But it also depends on when you're taking that forward. So, for example, when you're doing a launch of a restaurant, for argument's sake, you know that you're going to bring, let's say, 200 people into the space across stakeholders. And to understand what your repeat clientele is, that's direct connection to an ROI. Let's assume you're launching a new menu. You know that you've done XYZ in these many buckets, so you know what your ROI or what your footfall is already. So it's easy to measure. Where it's tougher to measure actually is FMCG brands. So, for example, let's assume you're working with, we've done some work with Tasty Treats. So you go out there. So we did the entire Varun Dhawan campaign with them, and especially during the IPL. So how do you measure that, right? All you do is you basically put it in the awareness bucket. So honestly, when you do look at PR, you need to look at it from three buckets that you fit in. You either do awareness, you either do visibility, or then you do ROI. So if you're at your launch phase, you're definitely looking at awareness mixed with visibility. If you're at your maturity space where you know you have a set clientele and you know that business has plateaued and you need to push that up, then you're definitely looking at a visibility to an ROI combination. So these three buckets, as long as you decide your overarching outcome, measuring is not that hard. It's a myth. Whoever says PR cannot be measured, it's a myth.
Okay, great. That's great to know. So Richa Ferwani says, for someone getting into the PR industry, what kind of work experience will be helpful?
That's also a great question. When I started out as an intern, I used to fax copies. I can't explain how tedious it is to actually take one sheet of paper, write a name with pencils, fax it, remove it, erase it, fax it all over again. So this is probably the best time to get into PR because it's so easy. Outreach is very easy thanks to digital platforms. So the first thing that I would suggest is forget about the money. Just get into an agency, whether it's big or small, it doesn't matter, that has a brand you believe in and a brand that you follow. So if you're somebody who follows, let's say MAC, the beauty brand, and you're an avid consumer, you get why you make a purchase decision, just get hired by the agency that manages PR. You'll make a lot of strong connections in your mind as to how something sold, why there was certain messaging. And the minute you have great work, PR is also a small team, and PR really values impact. So as long as you're doing great work, you have a very, very bright.
Okay, great. So now, of course, we're all going through this together, the pandemic, and currently we are in lockdown. What is the best strategy to adopt for PR during these tough times?
I'm
You
so
must have
sorry.
had to make a few changes. So you must have had to make a few changes in the way you're strategizing with brands during these tough times. So what's the best strategy to adopt during this pandemic if brands are approaching you to like continue work during this period?
Sean, I think you asked about how we changed design strategy during the pandemic. Like, how have we changed
Yeah, so how do
publicity
you do PR?
strategy
How do
during
you do
this time?
PR for a brand during the pandemic?
Got it. Firstly, we need to understand that all consumers are currently purchasing on faith. So it's honestly, I mean, when you go out, when you're picking up a grocery, you're picking up a piece of bread, or you're ordering cake, it's just because you have a notion that that place is doing its job. Of course, the brands are doing a great job of communicating what measures they're taking to sort of safeguard themselves and safeguard the customer. But anywhere across the sun, we need to at this point of time, we need to understand that it's a faith conversation. So at this time, what brands need to do is to communicate as openly and as honestly as possible. They need to, and we've seen success with brands that haven't sold their product as much as they've sold sort of what they stand for. So a lot of our clients, for example, like restaurant clients, they order from the same place as their own kitchen. So that's faith, right? Like that's putting your money where your mouth is. So so the communication right now has to be a lot more real. The communication has to be about what precautions we are taking. The communication also has to be a lot of listening. What does your what is the customer saying? What is his purchase call? How can you make that customer's time easier? Also, it's a little bit about an experience conversation, which means that everybody's at home at this point of time. So nostalgia is a very, very big angle at this point of time. Whatever you can use to invoke nostalgia really helps. Whatever a happiness conversation really helps at this point of time. So as long as we keep it emotional, we keep it real, and we keep it specific, I don't agree with the frequency being really, really loud because right now there's so much of fatigue of so much going on. as long as you communicate clearly, you're in a good state. And less, communicate less. Do
Okay.
not communicate more, communicate less.
Yes. Great. Okay, so a lot of the PR today, what I notice is a lot of paid PR out there. So it's a lot of articles that you can get by paying a certain amount or even a mention somewhere. It becomes like an ad, you know. So what's your take on how to differentiate paid media and actual PR articles which are not charged?
What's our take on what's my take on paid media?
So the difference, how do you differentiate between paid media and free media?
Hey,
What do you
Sean,
think
can you
of?
hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear you. I can hear you.
Sean, so
So
you are
what is the
asking
difference
for
between
my opinion on
differentiating
paid media,
between
is it?
paid media and PR, like an article which comes due to an agency, or you know, it's not plugged? Because a lot of the articles I see today are brands can just plug in by paying for it, and then you get a name mention. So how do you differentiate between the two? And what's your take on paid media? Yeah, that's also my question.
Very, very, very interesting question. I think brands need to also understand that all publications have their limitations as well, with respect to how much earned media they can offer a particular community. So I think it needs to be a balance. The reason I also mentioned it needs to be a balance is, a brand needs reviews of third-party credibility, but there are times a brand needs to say what a brand needs to say, which means that in that case, when you want to say something which is very specific in the exact same way that you want to say it, is when paid media is probably the most powerful tool. Because earned media definitely has one layer of an edit, of an understanding that you're interacting with a journalist or another sector, a
Yeah.
specific person on. So, I think that there needs to be a definite balance with respect to this. But also with respect to recognition, I think what we need to also acknowledge is that paid media gives you a lot of, it gives you the push when you need it. With earned media, you
Yes.
cannot dictate time, right?
Yes.
So we need to understand that when we are doing a campaign, it's not that the PR person didn't do their job. But the media mix has to include paid media purely so that you get the messaging out at the time you want to.
You know, that's very well said, because that's what a lot of people say, that why am I going through a PR agency if I had to pay for it? But you know, you wouldn't even know about it in the first place. And like you said in the beginning, your messaging has to be correct. So without that
Correct.
agency in the middle, I don't know what you're really going to be putting out there.
Correct.
So I completely agree. Thanks for that. So at this point, since a lot of people are home, I was chatting with Roshan Abbas on my live yesterday, and he said such a good
I saw.
point. He said, don't click the live button just because everyone's doing it. So I want to
Correct.
ask you this. What can a brand do at a point like this while everyone's at home, and honestly, everyone is like on their digital platforms? What can they do right now to get noticed, which is different, and not just go live because everyone's going live?
Remember I spoke about emotion and nostalgia just a few minutes ago. I think this entire live conversation, firstly, I think it's great, and I think all brands should have their own modality to say what they have to say. But when it comes to PR, honestly, and kill sue me for saying this, but the whole idea is to sort of collaborate with people who have an equal or better standing than you in the market, right? Which
Yes.
means that you'd like to attract newer customers. So first rule of going live is to go live collaboratively. When you're using your own lives, it's to communicate a direct message. But the idea of collaborations, A, there's something new, so that means there's new content discussion there. Secondly, both parties will benefit from the kind of communities both people bring to the table. So that's one thing that's important. So that's been a very recent learning. Secondly, with respect to tools of communication, we need to understand that WhatsApp is probably the smartest tool for communication. It's not
Yes.
digital media, it's not articles. So in short, Flipboard and WhatsApp. These are three places that we really, really need to concentrate on. Also because people are now aware of what fake news is, so they're open to listening to brands. What do they have to say when it comes right from the horse's mouth? And that gets circulated faster. So that would be my second aspect. The third very interesting learning, Shan, has been that we've benefited a lot more from communicating with or liaising with communities versus mass communication. What I mean by that is, again, let's assume there's an immunity building product that we have to launch during this time, right? And it's very relevant. Of course, you want to make it Googleable in the sense that you need enough people to have written about it so that when people go, there's discovery of that particular product. But the review aspect of it, the actual, you know, touch feel of it is only going to come from communities. It's going to come from people. So that's something that we need to keep in mind. Also, because right now, anybody who's buying a who's using a product is purchasing it. That means that that review cannot be fake. That means that review cannot be doctored. So this is the most honest time to be in PR.
Oh, yes.
So that would be another strategy shift. And last but not the least, I think journalists have a lot of, I mean, they're very open to listening at this point of time. So I feel like that old press release, you know, like hitting a press release button and disseminating mass is passe. I think conversations are really winning. So as long as you can co-develop an idea with a media house, you're co-developing an idea with a journalist, that's way stronger than hitting a press release and asking for coverage.
Yeah, you said it so well. You've really, really explained it so well. So we have a question from Mojito Fantastico who says, can you shed light, if possible, on the role of PR on the TikTok platform, a fast-growing platform?
I love TikTok. I absolutely love it. The campaign that will actually help you understand this best is Pepsi Swag campaign, actually, where
Pepsi?
They swag campaign. Her boot
okay.
mein swag hai. So,
yeah.
So you know, very interestingly, and you see this a lot for brands that are FMCG, mass brands, brands that are experientials like music, makeup, fashion. These guys are using TikTok in a very big way. However, what we need to acknowledge is TikTok is still penetrated a lot more in tier 2, tier 3 cities. So if that's your target audience, please definitely feel free to use it. I would also request you to please, as a brand, pay those TikTokers. It takes them a lot of time to create that kind of content. It is not available for free. It is an artist just like anybody else who deserves their dollar for it. So I think from that perspective, as long as you're tier 2, tier 3 mass market, TikTok definitely works. Also because it's very collaborative. You know, when you look at any other sponsored post, when you're sending an email, it still looks sponsored. TikTok gives you the freedom to be very collaborative and put your own layer to it. So it's a fun.
Yeah, great. So Race Menon says, if given a chance to switch your profession, what would you choose?
Firstly, hi to Race Menon. Reshmi, she used to work with us. She was one of our proteges before she moved on to greener pastures. If I had to switch a profession, I would go back to dancing. I used to be a dancer by profession a long, long time ago. It feels like a past life at this point of time. But I definitely go back to that. I think I want to be one of those, you know, Shan, very cheap thrill. I want to be one of those backup dancers behind Shahid Kapoor. I'm a big fan. I just want to be in the same frame as the man and I want to dance behind him. So another profession would be that.
Yeah, wow. I didn't know that was coming, but great. That's great to hear. So the other question that I have for you is, anyone who's starting out in the PR world, what's your advice to them? You know, some things that they should do, not do. Should you build a team very early or should you stick to, you know, doing it alone? Anything that you can share?
Sure. I actually have three very specific things I would like to communicate. One is PR is all about knowledge. So if you're somebody who keeping up with the trend, hey, can you get me now?
Yeah.
So I'm saying that I have three specific things that I would like to communicate. One is PR is all about knowledge. So if you're somebody who doesn't like keeping up with the trends, if you're somebody who cannot handle research, please don't pick this profession because then that's not for you. Research, whether you're executing, whether you're planning, whether you're collaborating, whatever aspect of PR you'd be in, research is your number one friend. So that's something that I would really, really want to encourage people to understand. Second is content writing. Content writing is a very, very big one in PR, which means that we really need to stop. I'm old school, so the TTYLs and TLDRs of the world still don't work because you send that to Forbes and you sort of watch what happens to you tomorrow. But my request
has that
would
ever
be
happened
to
you with a team member?
You know it has. And I think my team is here and they'll kill me after this because they all know how, I mean, they're one time they write TBH, and I'm asking some other team members because I don't want to seem stupid. Like, I have very, very young kids, and I
What is
really.
that? Even I don't know. Yeah.
TBH is to be honest.
Oh yeah, TBH. I heard TTH. Okay.
It's okay, I don't even know the others. So, you know, I mean, it's one way for me to feel old, but content writing is important. I think that as long as we know, you know, sort of, and basics, right? You know, how to just communicate clearly is good enough. That's something we need to know. And third is a general curiosity about things. You know, the language skill can be developed. The writing skill also at one point can be developed. But if you don't have a general curiosity to sort of do things, then I think PRs will just get very drab and it's going to seem stressful and all the other things that we read about. So
Yes.
my top three will be this.
Okay. So somebody else asks, when is the right time to start out on your own in the PR profession?
When was the last time?
When is the right time to start out on your own in the PR profession?
Anytime. I mean, so actually I must share something on with personal experience. I am the least ex one of the least experienced members of my own team. I'm blessed because a lot of people in my team have way more experience than me. I mean, I definitely have a lot of drive, and I think what ends up working in my favor is the fact that I can't hear a no. I mean, that word doesn't, like, it doesn't absorb in my brain or something. But I think what's important is to definitely work in an agency or an industry or a SPOPCOM or whatever you may be for at least 2 to 3 years to understand where you go with it. Because, you know, PR is also a lot about your mental health, if I may put it that way. I don't know if a lot of people acknowledge that or not, because you're listening to a lot of no's all the time. You're constantly going back to the board and drawing, you know, a new strategy, a new conversation all the time. So it takes a toll on what you think. So you need to get a little thick-skinned, you know, like rolling like, you know, water on moss and stone kind of thing. So I would say at least do put in your due for 2 to 3 years. I really wish I would have worked in an agency for longer, but I have no complaint. Luckily, my team makes up
Yeah.
my